She's an animal as an actor. She's an animal.
How did you end up starting in this business? What was your...
My dad, a New York City cop, very particular, eccentric cop. He was the guy who was in a squad car playing his guitar, and his partner, Frank Keating, was reading Joyce and Oscar Wilde. This was back in the 60s. And my dad loved cinema. My dad's Irish. And they grew up in Brooklyn and immigrants. And my dad would just sit me down in front of
the... He immigrated himself?
His mother came over from Ireland, from County Mayo in Ireland, Southern Ireland. And my dad would just... I would watch movies with my dad. And he would, in a layman's way, because he didn't really... he never studied film, but he would just talk to me about Howard Hawks and John Ford and Fleming and Houston, and then Jimmy Stewart, Jimmy Cagney, Paul Muni. I mean, whoever it was, there was a conversation going on. This is obviously back before there was cable, so you had Channel 5 or Channel 11, they have the movie of the week or whatever. And we would watch movies, and I just loved movies, probably because of his introduction to them. And then I just started going to movies all the time. And without sounding pretentious, but this is just the truth, and I think it's probably why there was something when I saw movies, that there was something about it that was like, it just spoke to me in a way that was like, that's mine. That I understand that. Because my days would be, I always felt like my eyes were a projector and everything I saw was like a movie screen. And I really used to think, and I didn't know what the fuck it meant, but that's always how I used to, everything always just seemed like a movie to me. So when my dad started doing it, and then I can remember going to see, you know, French Connection as a very little boy. And that film had a big impact on me. And I just started going to movies, man. I lived in movie theaters, and that just became my my dream was to, I didn't understand how to do it. It seemed like, you know, other people did those things because I didn't know anybody in the movie business. My mother was a school teacher. My dad was a cop. But that's just what I always wanted to do.
So how'd you find your way to a camera?
Well, the other thing that I had in my life was sports. My father loved sports, and my parents got divorced. So I played sports, I think probably because it kept me close to my dad also, and my dad would come to my games, and that's how I'd see him on weekends. And I was pretty good. When I got to my senior year of high school, I was pretty good at football, and I started getting recruited by colleges to play football in college. And I remember saying to my dad, but Dad, I want to make movies when I get older. I don't really, you know, like, this is what I want to do with my life. And he's, you know, like, okay, that's great. But like, so I got into fortunately, football helped me get into a very good school. And I played.
You're playing tight end?
No, I was an outside linebacker.
Okay.
I was an outside linebacker. But I went to the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia, and I found a great theater downtown Philly that I would spend my days and nights when I wasn't playing ball in the movie theater. And when I got out, I just started making short films. Well, I started studying there, but they didn't have a proper film school. They had a it was more theoretical and the communication school and the acting classes, and I took a Super 8 camera class and things like that. But it was pretty pedestrian. And you know, when I got out, I just started learning by doing. I didn't want to go to film school. I didn't want to work on other people's movies where people were, you know, what I was just kind of lugging. I just wanted to, like, I want to be an artist. That's what I wanted to do. So I started writing plays and making shorts and writing bad screenplays because I didn't really know what I was doing yet. But learning, you know, it's like someone becomes a doctor, you have to go to med school. You have to learn your craft. So that's what I was just doing in New York. And I worked in bars and banging around and lived in a little studio apartment. And I did that until Tumbleweeds.
And how did that come to fruition?
Well, Tumbleweeds came to fruition after several short films and plays. I met Angela Shelton, who I was dating at the time, and she had written this manuscript called Tumbleweeds, which was the story of her life. It was a sort of Kerouacian stream of consciousness story of like 800 pages. And I was like, wow, man, there's a movie in here, Angela. This covers 21 years of your life, but if we concentrated to a particular time and then capture the essence of these characters, your mom and you, and the themes that I'm feeling that are sort of coming off this, I said, there's a really interesting movie here. And I relate to it because, though I never traveled the miles, because she traveled all over the country with her mom. Her mother's always chasing men. I lived in motels with my father. That was my life growing up. I would get kicked out of my house from my mom, and my dad would come get me, and I'd live in Howard Johnson's motor lodges. So I understood this rootless kind of, this idea of searching for home, searching for place, searching, you know, for roots. I understood that, and though I didn't travel the miles. So I said to Angela, I said, I really get this. And I said, I'm going to approach it like it's a father and son, even though it's a mother and daughter. And that's what I did. And then she and I wrote it together. And then speaking of Janet McTeer, I had been reading about her in the papers in New York because she was on Broadway. And she had just won the Tony. And I remember reading the review in the New York Times. I think it was Vincent Canby who wrote it. And I remember he said it's the best stage performance he's ever seen. And I'm like, wow, that's heavy for that guy to say that. And just as that happened, she was on Charlie Rose. And I love Charlie Rose. I was a Charlie Rose junkie. So I saw the interview with her, and she was the character that we wrote, Mary Jo. Because Janet as a person, she was talking about her nieces and nephews, and she wasn't married, but so her parental kind of experience was as an aunt. And she was like Mary Poppins to me. That's what she reminded me. Plus she had the mouth of a sailor, and she was this broad, and she was witty, and she was bright, and she was, just had weight to her. And I'm like, that's Mary. And she said, but she was a Brit, of course. And I said, but that's Mary Jo. I tracked her down, got her the script. She didn't know me from an apple on a tree.
So you're a guy who's done some shorts.
Yeah.
And now you're adapting this book that hasn't been published at that point.
Yeah.
And really, did you like throw it over her dressing room door? I mean, is there an agent that you had that?
No, you know what I did was, remember Teddy Demi? Ted Demi and I made our first short film together. And Teddy and I have been friends since we're 18 years old. So Teddy tracked down her agent and got the script to the agent and said, my friend's making this movie. If you see Tumbleweeds, Teddy's actually an executive producer on the film. His name is on it. So he got it to her. And there was a note from me with my phone number. And she called me up. And she's like, I like this little script. Who are you? And she goes, come to my play. So I went and saw her. And I was like, I was just floored by what I was watching, this woman on the wings of madness on the stage. It was just mind-blowing, tour de force performance. And we went out afterwards and drank wine. And I was so obsessed with making this movie that I think I just, I somehow corralled her into this and I wouldn't let her go. Once I got my hooks in her, I was like, you're in this movie. And she went on the ride. It was like 4 years before we finally, I sold everything I owned, everything, and had enough to make the movie.
So how did you know you could deal with actors? Or did you? Were you just like going on faith?
No, you know, I'd been doing my homework. I was studying acting for a long time in New York, in acting classes, doing it myself, and most of my friends were artists. They were writers and actors and painters. So I was in that world. That was the world I like submerged myself in. So having been in acting classes, I understood not only process and craft, but you know, you know, there's no rules to this thing, really. So everyone has their own way of getting in the door of it and how they work, and that was really helpful. I love actors, so you know, working with them, and I'm very methody. I call myself a method filmmaker. So method actors, I don't have a problem with. As long as our processes align, we're going to be really good.
So this, so Warrior doesn't seem like it's too far off where you started with Tumbleweeds. I mean, without making any assumptions about your father or your life with your father, this material seems a little bit reflective of the thing that you found most compelling about that.
You know, there's an interesting continuity or a line that you can probably, which I never thought about until after I made, you know, way after Warrior was finished, but you know, from Tumbleweeds to Miracle, which was, you know, touched upon my athletic kind of life. And that actual game, the only reason I did that movie was because I couldn't get Pride and Glory made. And my agents kept telling me, you need to do a studio movie. They just think you're some little independent filmmaker, so you got to make a studio movie. And I kept reading, as you know, I said, okay, and then I started getting scripts, and I'm like, this is just, I can't believe they're actually going to make this. Really? This is really what it's come to? This is really what they want to? I can't do it. And then I got the script for Miracle, which I honestly didn't think was great. But I had a personal experience with that, because I remember with that game, I was sitting this close to the television. And when they won, people in my neighborhood with pots and pans, and we were out screaming. So for whatever reason, I had a personal connection to. And then I also understood, once I started climbing inside it, I got about a guy who puts his family on a shelf and chases a dream, all this stuff. And then to Pride and Glory, to Warrior. There's a continuity, I think you can probably draw a line, of things personally in my life that you can kind of connect the dots getting to Warrior, which was, I think, in a way of me maybe finding my voice, maybe.
Well, Warrior feels like this... this epic combination of two different kinds of movies kind of...
Gene spliced.
Coming together, yes.
Yeah.
Was that what, when it first came into your world, was it that? Or is it, has that been what you've helped create it, make it into?
Well, that's a good question. I think that, you know, part of it had to do with understanding the commerciality of cinema today. So there was a very sort of intimate kitchen sink drama that I wanted to make. But I also, having made Miracle, I understood the power of what sports or competition can do cinematically. So once I started doing an autopsy on the characters and I think, you know, starting to cull what was inside of me, this movie became sort of what I call like almost an exorcism. And I didn't get this exorcism of what was happening inside of me. And then I was working with my friend Anthony, who I, you know, he had things going on. So we were, but I kept saying I want the movie to be, you know, this like intervention. And then, you know, then this idea of mixed martial arts, which I love, and I hadn't seen it in cinema before. And this idea of what I said, no, it's going to be an intervention in a cage where one brother is going to save the other brother's life because these guys grew up communicating through violence. Because all this is all, you know, part of the DNA of the movie, you know, we're going to drive towards one brother saving the other brother's life by beating the shit out of him. And he's got to slay his brother in front of his dad. And the brother has to die to be reborn to save the family. Witnessed by the father, because the brothers have to come together and the that's the beginning of the healing. They're going to heal and reclaim their lives with their fists. And Anthony, remember, he's like, dude, that's crazy. I know, but that's what we're going to do. That's right. That's going to be right. That's what we're driving towards.
But it's classic in a way also. I mean, it's not, the idea of that is, you know, Greek.
It's very Greek. It's Shakespearean. It's Greek. Yeah. And well, that, well exactly. That's why, then I, you know, once I got that, then it's like, okay, Theognis, the great Greek fighter, the greatest Greek fighter during Homer's, you know, time, pre-Socrates, pre-Plato. Like, okay, now he's in the movie because, yes, it's a Greek drama. So, yes, that's exactly.
So did, was there somebody to say, wow, that's great, or oh my God, you're scaring us at this point?
What do you, you mean on the like agent or studio?
Was the studio
side?
Developing this movie?
No,
or you
no,
just,
no,
at this point
no.
You're just developing?
No, you know what happened was when I finished Pride and Glory, which I made at New Line, Toby Emmerich said to me, what do you want to do next? We just were like wrapping up. Mm-hmm. I think I was mixing P&G at the time. He goes, what do you want to do next? And I told him the story, broad strokes. He goes, I'm in, let's do it together. He goes, I want to make another movie with you. I said, mm-hmm. Great. So as we started doing it, writing it, and I hadn't given everything yet, but just the idea of New Line folded. Warner Brothers absorbed them. And Toby called me up and he said, you got to get out of here. He goes, I'm telling you, because Warner Brothers, I'm not making the movie. Right. They're never making the movie. So he goes, go with God. So then we just wrote the movie on our own and then set it up with Lionsgate later. That's how it happened.
So when you got to Lionsgate, they were great? Let's figure out casting? Or what were you?
No, they were amazing. It was weird. I sat down with Mike Pasternak and Joe Drake and they said, we want to make this movie. We love it. And you know, and they said, we like, you know, you and your work, and we think like we want to do this. It got complicated after that, but they right my first meeting, they said they wanted to do it.
And how did you end up with this cast? Because you know, obviously set the bar very low for yourself as a director. Very easy group to work with.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I had already we wrote the part for Nolte. Mm-hmm. Nick was supposed to be the dad in Pride and Glory. He was the dad for a year. He and I lived near each other. We created a Bible for the character. And then Nick had to have reconstructive knee surgery right before we started shooting his scene. So I got Voight to come in at the last minute.
So you've worked through things with him
previously.
As the actor and director before, yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
And when Nick was leaving, I said, Nick, give me the Bible we created because this is going to Voight now.
Right.
And, you know, do your thing. He and I remained friends. I love Nick. So when we were writing this movie, we wrote it for Nick. Nick was the first guy to read the script. And I'm in. Yeah, I'm doing this movie with you. Jesus Christ, this is some tough terrain. Yeah. The problem was getting the studio to go along with that. They didn't want Nick. They wanted, because what I had said to them was, once they said they wanted to make it, I said, okay, but like, I don't want to use movie stars.
Right.
I was using Rocky. Rocky was a big sort of seminal film for me as a kid. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know, I didn't know who Sylvester Stallone was before Rocky, which is actually not true. I did know who he was because I had seen, because I was such, I'd seen The Lords of Flatbush because I was a little movie geek. So I was one of the few people on the planet that actually went and saw that in the movie theater because it was released.
But you'd not seen The Italian Stallion, most likely.
I hadn't seen any of that stuff yet. None of the softcore. No, I hadn't seen that.
Didn't come back.
Too young for that. Yeah, I didn't do that. But the point was, I said, no one knew who. I said, if James Caan or Ryan O'Neal or all the other people that they were supposed to play that part, it would have been a very different film.
Yeah.
So I said, the fact that we didn't know Stallone and he was that guy, I said, that, and beyond all the other narrative elements that worked perfectly in that film, it's why the movie worked. I said, I want to do the same thing with Warrior. So they agreed to that, which of course now the budget came down. You know, I was putting a lot of money back in. I ended up working for about $1 an hour on this film when all said and done, which is fine. But then Nick, you know, the part of the old man was the linchpin. And, you know, when I said, well, you know, I wrote this for Nick and Anthony and I wrote this for Nick and you know, they were like, well, this, you know.
Can you get Nicholson?
You know, he's not worth a lot of money in, you know, Portugal or wherever, you know. So he's sort of on the way out, not in. And so we had to go through a lot of pretending to go through the cast list and you know, some people that were so egregiously wrong, yet probably brought more value to the movie.
That's a pretty small group. It's got to be a pretty small group. There are not a lot of guys of that age that are still buckling.
You know, it was a small group that got bigger, but Nick kept getting pushed over here. Yeah. I mean, it was amazing how it kept getting longer when I was rejecting until Nick could just never move to the front of the line, ever. And I would just say to Nick, I'm like, dude, I promise you, you're going to play Patty. Just sit tight. He and I would do work on the character for, you know, 8 months, 9 months before we started prepping. And he did that work. And finally they said, you know, I think I wore him down, to be honest with you.
And the boys, Hardy being the the Brando of the group, I guess.
Yeah. You know, this was a hard, they were really hard parts to cast. I met everyone here in, you know, in America and, you know, all these actors, real actors, because I wanted real actors, but actors that you hadn't heard, you know, most people hadn't heard of
them. Right.
And I couldn't find them. And then.
But there is a lack of macho in the male casting pool. It's been a big conversation.
In American, about, yeah. In American cat.
Why movie stars have not emerged the way they used to, male movie stars.
Why is that?
I guess it was our moms or something.
I call them doily actors. They're like a lot of doilies out here. It's weird.
Yeah.
You know, and I needed guys. So, I mean, you know, Tommy started with Randy Hiller, my casting director, after Hundreds. He's like, she's this guy named Tom Hardy. I'm not an internet guy. I don't tweet. I don't do any of this stuff. So I don't know. Like, I just don't. So she was like, she got me online. This is him. And then she got me on the phone with him.
Mm-hmm.
And then he started calling me at all hours of the night, forgetting that I was in Los Angeles and he was in London. And my little girl would be like, it's 4 o'clock in the morning, Daddy. I'm like, I know, I don't know. He's an actor, whatever. And then I got the studio to fly.
You train her early. So when she's ready to date, she knows. Yeah. Stay away from the actor.
Yeah, exactly. I asked the studio, and then when Tommy and I was, he kept telling me he couldn't audition. He was terrible at auditioning, which I understood. I've met actors that are not good at auditioning.
Mm.
I've met actors that give their best performance during the audition, which is the worst.
Mm-hmm.
You don't get any more than that. So I'm very careful of, like, when someone gives the greatest audition ever, it's like, okay, maybe that's all you're ever going to get.
Right.
And I've seen that too. So the studio flew Tommy in. And he ended up living with me for 5 days, and I got the camera, and we worked at it every day, and we got to know each other very well, and we hung out together for 5 days and nights, and worked on it every day. Tommy was very scared because of the dialect, the physicality, the fighting. There were so many things that were so far from who he is, even the working classness of it, which Tommy's not doesn't come from working class London. He's not that guy.
Mm-hmm.
So there was so he was, and I kept going, I'm telling you, Tommy, you are the guy. I knew he was the guy. And then we finally got him.
So what was it that you saw that made you feel like it was he was the guy? If he was not so sure.
Tommy has, what I needed more than anything else was, when you meet the character, there needs to be this exterior that is macho and rough. But you needed to be able to look in that boy's eyes or man's eyes and see the boy inside. And you need to see that there's an immense amount of vulnerability there and pain, and you needed to know that because he does dastardly things and says dastardly things, and his fighting is such a statement. He's got so much self-hatred, his character, and his fighting is such a statement against his despisal of God in a way, that you needed to know that all that pain and anger was, that you needed to empathize with him. You couldn't, the wrong actor, you just not like him.
Right.
Because and I knew that, and Tommy had, there were things in Tommy's own life that were analogous, just in regards to the emotional pain.
Right.
And I knew that I knew that he can, there was a light that would come out of him. And I also knew, to be honest with you, I said, this kid's a movie star. And the studio kept saying, I'm like, that's a tall order. Find two movie stars, really? Mm-hmm. Like, there's not that many movie stars on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew this kid was a fucking movie. I just knew it. And this is before Bronson. Right. I cast him before Bronson.
Huh.
He had already made Bronson. I hadn't seen it yet.
Right.
It was just going, this is before it went to Sundance.
Huh.
And I we got him in the movie. And then he had to do a lot of physical work and a total transformation.
Mm-hmm.
And
I mean, he's one of those guys who does that, though.
He loves it. He's a methody guy. He's a very methody guy. And then Joel was, I just needed a guy who, you know, the thing about Joel is Joel has more integrity And forget about actors that I know, just about anybody I know. Joel has got integrity. He's a great, he's a gentleman. Mm-hmm. If he gives you his word, it's his word. If you want someone in your foxhole, you want Joel. He's that guy.
I thought you just saw Kinky Boots and immediately assumed.
No.
This is your guy.
I know, you think, right? Yeah. He's a great actor. Mm. They had sent me, so he had auditioned and I saw it online. And then they when he came out, he actually came up to my house too. I didn't even do these auditions, and I just had people come up to my house and do this stuff when I was really interested. It's just a more relaxed, it's a very artificial kind of environment when you audition, and it's hard. So I just wanted to be very casual.
Were you auditioning other people in the midst of this, or were you?
Yeah, but up there. But with these two guys, I don't know why, my antenna was like, these guys feel very right to me. Because Joel had auditioned, he had done several scenes, and I saw it online.
Right.
He was in Sydney at the time. So, and then I asked for tape on him, and I had gotten this, he did this monologue from Henry II that floored me. He was like, I'm like, this guy's Richard Burton, man. he's Richard Burton without the, you know, the booze.
Yeah.
He came to the house. I really liked him. We played with the scenes. And ultimately, the thing about Joel is, when I looked at him, I said, when this guy's in his higher self, I love him as a family man, as a husband, as a father, as a pillar in the community, as a teacher that his students love, as that guy. I said, but I also can look at him and go, you know what, when he was 18, 19, 20 years old, he was belly up at the bar, putting him down and getting into fights. I could see him, that in him too. He had that duality that was very important. So when he stepped into a cage, you can believe he had that other side of him. There was a primal part of him that he had. And he had fucking chops, man, as an actor. And I really liked him. So that's kind of what
I was. So is Joel as methody as the other two? Or was it the same kind of? Because it sounds like the experience with Nick and the experience with Tom were similar in certain ways in terms of the amount of depth you guys dove in.
Yeah, he wasn't a lot, you know, Joel was, I did a lot more, I did less biographical work with Tommy than I did with Joel. You know, Tommy at times was becoming so methody that he was becoming the character, which pissed me off because the character's a cocksucker at times. So sometimes Tommy would be a cocksucker and he wouldn't do things I needed him to do. And he would go, you know, Tommy wouldn't do that. I'm like, I know, but I'm not rolling cameras right near Tom. So, but Tommy wouldn't, Tommy wouldn't do that. So Tommy, you know, doesn't listen to anybody, the character. So it was hard sometimes for Tommy. So we had this really weird kind of, whereas Joel, his apartment, we lived in a building in Pittsburgh where Tommy lived on the first floor. I was on the fourth and Joel lived right next to me. So there was this open door thing going on with me and Joel and Frank Grillo, who played the trainer. Where we were doing a lot of work on the scripts at night, on weekends. I'd be shooting. Hey guys, let's improv that scene in the gym. You know, let's just improv it. So what do you want in the scene, Joel? Well, we'll go get it from him. And then we would just do an improv. And they would start, and then I would be rewriting it. And that's kind of how we worked.
So was your experience like this on any of the other movies?
Yeah, always. That's my process. I have to.
So even a miracle, Disney's letting is. Comfortable with you making changes on the run? And
oh, I rewrote that script. I rewrote Miracle. I rewrote the script. You know, the guy, if you look, when you watch that movie, the guy who got screenwriting credit, I didn't even know who he was. I never read his script. Because we went to the Writers Guild with me and, you know, I got Mike Rich got the movie greenlit. Then I rewrote Mike Rich. And when we were done, my agent said, all right, you know, we're going to go to the Writers Guild. You know, maybe you and Mike will.
Right.
Share, and then neither me or Mike got the screenwriting credit. It was some guy, Eric Guggenheim, and I was like, who's that guy? And they said he wrote the original draft, and then he got fired because his draft didn't go. But Miracle was a historical document. So in all of our drafts, Herb Brooks puts a team together, the same players, and he wins a gold medal. So that's how they look. And I kept going, but the connective tissue is entirely different.
It's one of the strange things in WGA.
I don't know.
I've been through that process a couple times. It's not fun.
Yeah.
It's like, as long as you, I mean, you can change every word, you can change every character, and yet somehow, if that basic idea is there.
It's a weird thing, yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't, you know, some of these guys in the Writers Guild were, you know, I don't know, you know, they're a bit of a dinosaur, some of these guys, you know.
Well, I don't know if they know they can't quite figure out an alternative that works either. You know, it's like, you can't, it's such a precious thing to get that credit that people don't always tell the truth. They're not always fair about it. You know,
And I also understand that they, you know, the whole intent always feels that they're trying to protect the original writer, but even, you know, a lot of work, in any event, it is what it is.
So was the experience of shooting, is that where you get your jollies? Is that when you're actually on the stage and you're actually putting this thing on its feet? Is that when you're happiest, or?
Yeah, I'm happy. We didn't shoot any stage. I'm not a big stage guy. We were out on real locations the whole time. I'm just happy making the movie. I'm very, I call it, you know, someone once said to me, you know, like, have a good day at work today. I said, I'm not going to work, man. I'm going to play. And that's how I look at it. I'm going to play every day. I honestly view this as like, I'm so blessed and so grateful to be able to do this, to be able, you know, this is one of those jobs that you do for free. Mm-hmm. We've done it for free. So to be able to make a living at this and to be able to express myself through this medium is a blessing. So I work really hard. And I just pour myself into it because I feel very fortunate and lucky and grateful, and every part of the process is embraced with just immense enthusiasm and passion.
And how intense is the post for you? Are you finding the movie in post, or do you really know where you are and you're just figuring out how best to put it together?
It's very different on each movie. This movie in particular was very difficult to find. Yeah. Finding the back half of the movie, the pacing of the tournament, and then the plumbing, the piping between the tournament, and all the rhythms of that were very difficult. Here's the truth: I spent a year cutting the movie. Mm-hmm. I had 12 weeks to cut the movie. My 12 weeks came up by, and I was like, guys, we're not even close. Like, because the other problem was, when we collapsed the budget, I had 6 weeks to prep the movie. That's usually you get 10, 12, and whatever, longer. I had six, I had eight on Tumbleweeds. Mm-hmm. I had 6 weeks of prep. Mm. So when I showed up day one, I brought my crew together and I said, here's the deal, guys. We have 6 weeks. That's six weekends. If we work every day over those six weekends, that gives us another 12 days. That gives us almost 8 weeks. So we're working every day until we start shooting. Once we start shooting, we're going to be working every weekend through the shoot until we're done. That's what's happening. Whoever's not in for that, leave now. People left. The people that stayed, we made the movie. The problem was I shot over a million feet of film, and I couldn't watch all the film. You know, all my dailies. I couldn't get through it all because I was working on weekends, preparing for the next week. So when I finished the movie, I had to get through over a million feet of film, and I look at every frame. I don't not go through it. So I kept saying to the studio, I'm like, 12 weeks? Like, it's going to take me 12 weeks just to get through all the footage.
Yeah.
So I'm never going to have this ready in 12 weeks. And it just became this thing, and then I ended up going to New York and cutting to get away, 3,000 miles away, and we spent about a year editing the movie.
Does the technology of the moment make it easier to do that and get away with the budgeting of that kind of thing?
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, can you do a lot of that work offline before you're in a more expensive cutting room and everything else? Or is it the same cutting room and they just have to figure out how to pay for it and screw it?
It's the same cutting room. We went from a cutting room here to a cutting room in New York, but the editing process is not, that's not that expensive. It's a couple of guys in a room and some assistants. It's not a big, on the line items of making movies, it's not that crazy, so.
But a year is unusual.
It's very unusual. I've never done that. So, like, this was an anomaly. I'd never done that before, but I kept saying to the studio, I haven't found, when we did our first test screening, the movie was 2 hours and, I don't know, almost 40 minutes long. And they kept saying to me, we've never tested a movie here at Lionsgate that's over 2 hours. That's our rule. And I said, okay, but are you telling me that in a week you expect me to get 40 minutes out of it? I said, I don't know what to cut. Mm-hmm. So if we just put this up in front of an audience, I'm not telling you it's going to be a 2-hour and 40-minute film.
Right.
I don't want it to be, nor think it, but I don't know what to cut. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a bad idea just to get it cut 40 minutes out if you don't know what 40 right. minutes. So let's put it up, mm-hmm. screen it, feel the room, learn from the experience. And it was valuable. That was the big, that's what started mm-hmm. the whole finding the movie that really helped me. And it also would help the studio because they did their questionnaires. Mm-hmm. With a 2-hour and 40-minute movie, we scored an 88, which they were like, holy shit. They didn't expect that.
Yeah.
So that gave me a little bit of breathing room to go cut longer.
So is what we ended up seeing the skinny version of that 2-hour and 40-minute movie, or did it change in a substantive way?
No, it was just massaging, culling, shaping, mm-hmm. mostly the back end of the movie. I think I got another 20 minutes out. Hmm. What's my running time? I'm about 220, I think it is.
So when was the first time you saw the one that ended up being the movie with an audience?
That's a good question. I don't remember. Huh. There was a couple of screenings along right. the way, because when I finished the film, we were just sort of dead for a while because they didn't have a release date and they didn't right. really know what they were going to do. So it just sat around for a while. So I don't remember when that happened.
So when that happened, that moment came. That was the movie.
Oh yeah, you know when it happened? That's right. They ended up doing. I had asked the studio, I said, now that it's done and they were going to start making a plan, I said, can we like put this version up in front of an audience just so we can learn maybe how to market it? Mm-hmm. Not that we're touching the movie, it's finished.
Right.
And we did that, and I think we got like a 91 that day. Mm-hmm. And it sort of started to inform how to market the film. So I thought.
So how painful? Has it been hard? I mean, the movie got some stellar reviews. It yeah. got some dismissals from some people. But it got a lot of amazingly strong reviews. And the audiences that I ever hear from seem to all love it when they get their butt into the theater. But they didn't all get their butt into the theater. What is that like for you?
The Sunday night after we opened... The weekend that we opened, I went back to New York for a charity that I started with my friends 10 years ago. We lost a very dear friend on 9/11, so we started a charity in his name. We do it every year. It just so happened that we were opening the weekend of the charity. Mm-hmm. We do it up in Woodstock. So I went home for the charity, my fiance and I. Mm-hmm. No cell phone service up there, which was great. So I didn't know what was going on, which was fine with me. When I made it back to New York City on Saturday night, we left on a Thursday, I got the dismal emails of where, because they know by Friday where the things, mm-hmm. it's unbelievable. They can project, as you know.
Generally.
Yeah. And in any event, I flew back on Sunday because the band The National, which mm-hmm. is the song that I bookend, the band that I bookend the film with, mm-hmm. They were performing at the Hollywood Bowl and they'd become friends of ours. So we went to see them play. And as I'm walking into the Hollywood Bowl, I see my co-writer and probably my dearest friend, Anthony Tambakis. Mm-hmm. And he kind of came over and hugged me like mm-hmm. we were at a funeral or something like that. And I said to him, this is the reason why you fight for your film. And this is the reason why you don't cave on anything creatively when you believe you're right. Because in the end, no matter what happens, if the movie makes $4, it's our movie. Mm-hmm. And I can't be upset. I'd be upset if I listened to everything that I was asked to do. Mm-hmm. And we still ended up in the same place, I'd be upset. But what we can, I said, Ant, what we can control, we did it, and we won. And that's honestly how I feel. Like the marketing, the box office. We had so many conversations with the, who knows. I don't know, and I don't want to point any fingers because I don't know. I can tell you this: I know the studio really cared, and I know that they, their hearts were always in the right place, and I think they had the same, not only aspirations but belief in what the film could do, as we all did. I don't know. I don't know.
So is that how you feel generally with all of your films? Yeah. That you, that the film is the film, and that all the other stuff, while obviously important on some level, is afterward.
You know, you find the joy in what you can control and the making of it, the creation, and after that, you have no control of it anymore. And I used to say to the studio all the time when they would, you know, whatever we, at times we had, and I would say, do you think you know the movie better than me? Because if you know it better than me, we're fucked. You don't. And I don't know how to market movies better than you guys. If I did, we're fucked. I don't. I'm not going to pretend I do. I'm going to tell you what the movie's about, what I think, but I'm never going to say that I know how to market, distribute. I don't know what this, but so that's your side of the street. And this is my side of the street. So I'm going to do my job and deliver the film. And then you guys do, and not that they didn't do their job, but it, you know, there's certain things that you can't control. I don't, and I don't know what that is. I have no idea. I can tell you, David, that the movie that is finished is the movie I always set out to make, and I'm really proud of it. And I'm proud of so many people that worked on this film. It takes, you know, I call making movies a team sport. We're not home alone with an easel and a paintbrush. You need a lot of people to pull this off. And I surrounded myself with some great, talented unknowns. And those are my favorite people. My cinematographer, Masa.
Yeah.
He made a he had made only a $3 million movie before Warrior. No one ever, I don't even think he got distribution. He shot some, you know, second unit stuff. No one knew who this guy was. But I'm like, this guy's got it. This guy's a superstar. He just needs a chance. Everyone in the movie was underdogs. I surrounded myself with just underdogs, underdogs, underdogs. Those are my favorite. I don't want to work with people that all won Academy Awards. Who cares? I want to find people that I think are really talented and successful and can be successful, people that need a shot. Those are my favorite. They work harder. They pour the, they'll fucking cut blood for you. That's what I want to surround myself with. Masa now, he finished my movie. He went and shot The Gray for Joe Carnahan. Then I get a call from my other friend, David O'Russell, goes, well, you know, Gav, what, you know, I'm looking for a DP. I said, Masa, David, I promise you, Masa. Masa's shooting David O's movie now. So he went from Warrior to The Gray to David O's movie. That's not bad.
No.
For a guy that had, you know. So there are a lot of, so many people like that, that just, I'm very, I'm really happy for them. And I think it's good.
When he did beautiful, beautiful work. I mean, it really is pretty lush and unusual. I mean, one of the shocking things to me about the picture is still the fights and how completely clean and beautiful they were. I mean, really haven't seen, I don't think there's been a better fight movie in terms of the visuals, you know, that I can think of, really.
We storyboarded every fight. That's one of the other things we were doing on weekends. I said to Masa, you got the job. You know, for, you know, he's Japanese, and you want to talk about a work ethic. This guy, he's amazing. And we would hold, me, Masa, and Jamie Marshall, my AD, and ended up getting a co-producer credit, and my storyboard artist, would hole up in my apartment all weekend, and we just drew, and we storyboarded every fight. And my whole apartment was just filled with images of had the whole fight, the whole tournament was on my walls. And then we had to, and we visualized that, which, you know, he, Masa and I spent a lot of time before we even went to Pittsburgh, him coming up to my house for free, figuring out a visual style for the movie. That was net, because I knew when we got to Pittsburgh, it's too late then to start figuring it out. You gotta, you, you know, you make the movie before you make the movie. So he gave me so much free time. And it was worth it. You know, I mean, see what he's doing now. He's amazing. He's a beautiful guy and a beautiful artist and a hard worker.
So does part of you like being the underdog? And is that part of your character that you yourself?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
If this movie had taken off and been a $200 million movie, would it in some ways have encroached on your ability to go do art?
Well, you know, underdogs eventually win. So, I would love it if this, you know, I haven't made a movie that's ever, you know.
Well, Miracle was a commercial surprise. I mean, I think that movie did better than people, I think, thought.
Yeah.
Going out.
Yeah, that's true.
And Tumbleweeds came out of nowhere and
you
know,
true.
Had a life. And Pride and Glory also had a hard birth.
Very true.
A company that was floating at the time.
Yeah. Yeah, I like being... that's always been my feeling of being, and I think I've been an underdog in everything I've done. I mean, just the fact that I'm sitting here right now with you, I think you ask any teacher I ever had, they're like, what? He ended up doing what? He was, you know, I don't know what we expected out of that guy, but, you know, and having not known anybody in the industry or, you know anything. Yeah, I've always viewed myself as, I like that.
Well, it sounds like mixing, that part of the work for you is mixing it up. That it's not, you know, that you're getting in there and doing it at the house and doing it on weekends and doing it in ways that, you know, are not what is necessarily by the book is part of what gets you to where you need to go.
Yeah. Well, the thing about having never gone to film school and having never worked in anybody else's movies, mm-hmm. which I really did consciously, was because it's art and I want to view this as art, there's no right or wrong. There's no rules. All I always say to people is, this is how I have to do it. So if you guys are cool about my process, mm-hmm. we're going to be great. I've had people that aren't, and it didn't go well.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a way that I like to do things, and it's like, you know, it's climbing. You just keep climbing deeper and deeper into it. You keep shaving it down and shaving it down until you get to the fucking the cell of it. And always trying to find the truth. And I'm not going to say I always find it, but that's what I'm always going for. And also trying to, and I'm not saying I've ever done it, but I'm like, if you're a writer, I want to know that you're trying to write the great American novel. Just mm-hmm. try. If you're not trying, fuck you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really how I feel. So I'm trying to make something great. I'm not saying I've ever done it, but I can tell you this, I'm going to keep on trying.